Welcome everybody, this is Yasser Al-Wasifi from Learn Dental Series. In this episode, we will continue and finalize our discussion about indirect metallic restorations and our example, which is the indirect gold restoration. First of all, let me disclaim and declare that I don't receive fees, compensation or royalties from the sales of any of the products shown or discussed. Also, this presentation has not been sponsored by any company, agency or organization and is prepared only for educational purposes. Let me remind you also that this presentation is copyright protected and couldn't be transmitted or reproduced by any means unless you have a written permission of from the author. Okay, today we will discuss the preparation of compound or complex class 2 preparation for cast gold restoration. In the previous episodes, as an overview, okay, about what we have been discussed, okay, we discussed in part 1 the material review, including history of development and introduction, definitions, composition and classification of dental gold alloys, and what are their advantages and disadvantages, and how to assign indications and contraindications based on the material advantages and disadvantages. Then comes part 2, which includes cavity preparation. We already discussed the principles of cavity preparation of indirect metallic, especially indirect gold restorations, including developing path of insertion and what are the differences in outline form between direct and indirect metallic restorations, what is the concept of bevel, why we should provide stability, and how to gain retention, especially axial one. Okay, then we concluded this, okay, in the form of general features of prepared cavity. Now in this episode, we will discuss in details how to prepare class 2 compound or complex for cast gold restoration or indirect gold restoration. In general, according to the available accessibility, how far posterior you are in the oral cavity, and according to the proximal caries extension and cervical anatomical cervical constriction of the tooth, class 2 for indirect restoration, especially for gold, could be prepared in a form of regular or default or routine black box cavity, which is exactly similar to that for amalgam, except for the direction of walls divergency and a little bit modifications related to the technique and to the material, or in a form of proximal slice. Then you will have an occlusal box like that of amalgam, but you will not have a proximal box. Okay, you will have a proximal slice like that for full coverage crown. Okay, then let us start with black box preparation. As the preparation should have a definite path of insertion, where in this direction there should not be any undercuts, okay, to allow easy insertion and removal of your wax pattern of your inlay, we should use the following pairs: tapered fissure pair, fine tapered fissure pair, fine tapered diamond stone, okay, which have a divergency of 5 to 8 degrees, which is the required divergency we need. Okay, but we didn't use any inverted cone, as surely it will create undercuts that will need to be corrected by fissure pair, which means that you will extra widen your cavity to correct this undercuts. Okay, initial entrance as usual from any weak point, okay, if it is not carious, if it is not opened by itself by the lesion, okay, or by the destruction, you will get initial entrance from a weak point, which is a central fossa, or in our case, as this premolar is through triangular fossa. Lateral extension is as usual to include all bits in the fissure, okay, and to extend the cavity margins, okay, to area self-cleansable using this tapered fissure pair, not inverted cone pair, to involve all bits and the fissure. Then comes the dovetailing of the proximal wall to provide lateral retention. If you remember, in fundamentals of tooth preparation, we mentioned that this dovetail, okay, is either an outline form or either extension for retention. It differs according to the dimensions of the triangular fossa. In molars, the dimensions of triangular fossa is wide paccolingual. That's why when you try to extend your cavity, you involve all of these stagnation areas, okay, it will be cut automatically by default in a form of dovetailing, okay? You are not intending to cut it, okay? That's why it is considered as extension for prevention, okay? It's a part of outline form. But here, okay, in our premolar, it is considered as extension for retention. You intentionally cut it to produce lateral retention because already the dimensions of your triangular fossa paccolingually is too small to create this shape. That's why after you extend your cavity laterally to involve this triangular fossa, okay, and this to reach the self-cleansable area in proximal in other proximal wall, okay, you need to refine and increase your extent slightly a bit in a paccolingual direction to create a proximal dovetail, because as you could see in our schematic diagram, it is one of the most important lateral extension features. Then to the other side, to include our cares and prepare the proximal box, you are in need for undermining of the proximal wall to cut the proximal cavity of the other side, okay, by thinning the marginal ridge and widen the extension paccolingually to ensure that your walls, buccal walls and lingual walls of your proximal box will be located in a self-cleansable area, which is the embrasures, buccals and buccal and lingual embrasures, okay. Then comes the role of tapered fissure bur to cut the proximal outline deeper, to go deeper to create a gingival seat, okay, and to create the axial wall, okay, without removing the proximal enamel plate, okay, by undermining your marginal ridge, and at the same time your tibet fissure is cut downward to the direction, to the gingival direction, to involve your carious lesion and create your axial wall and gingival seat, and these are most of the components of your proximal box. Then the tapered fissure is used to cut the proximal walls and adjust their direction to be slightly diverged for the required divergency, which is 5 to 8 degrees from the longer axis. Okay, to finish your proximal outline, okay, you need to finish your proximal outline before removal of the proximal enamel plate. As you could see, all of your proximal box is finished, okay, inside your cavity from inside, and you leaving proximal enamel plate of the affected side by cares, okay. But this is not the true case. The true case, this is a laboratory case, okay. But the true case is it actually opened because of cares, okay. Otherwise, cold is not indicated in such a sound tooth, okay, or such a superficial cares, okay. Cutting from inside, as we discussed before, under the fundamentals of tooth preparation, is termed proximal ditch technique. You are ditching the proximal from inside. You are cutting from inside, leaving undermined proximal enamel plate. This will provide a guide to you to place the buccal and lingual walls in a self-cleansable areas, which are buccal and lingual embrasures, okay. As you could notice the dotted line, okay, it guides you how much paccolingual extension you are in need to cut to get your walls, buccal and lingual walls of proximal box in a self-cleansable area. Also, it provides protection of the neighboring tooth from traumatic injuries by your bare while you are flaring your proximal cavity, providing also protection of the gingival tissues while you are refining the gingival seat. Also, it is so that it provides less heat generation as you are cutting in a softer dentine rather than enamel from inside rather than from outside. After that, by using any hand cutting instrument like enamel hatchet, gingival marginal trimmer, any bent angle chisel, but most favorable is the enamel hatchet, you cut the enamel plate, okay, using this hand cutting instrument, followed by refining by tapered fissure bur. Also, this tapered fissure bur, okay, with its fine tapered, with its recommended divergency of 5, or recommended tapering of 5 to 8 degrees, okay, are used to cut the proximal axial grooves. The proximal axial grooves are cut by placing this fine tapered fissure at the axiobuccal and the axiolingual line angle, just pressing it half the thickness to create this groove, okay? Your cutting should be directed toward buccal and lingual rather than axial, because if you cut in a direction of axial wall, number one, you are endangering the bulb, especially if the case is extensively damaged before you start your preparation, okay? But the most important, it will not provide the lateral retention and the stability required, because it could displace or couldn't resist displacement of restoration in in lateral direction. Also, I would like to remind you about the role of these proximal axial grooves. Number one, these proximal axial grooves mainly adds lateral retention, okay, as you could note in this schematic diagram. It is cut in buccal and lingual rather than axial directions, okay, at the axiobuccal and the axiolingual line angles, by being cut in a lateral direction, okay, rather than axial direction. It will provide, number one, lateral retention, number two, stability that provides displacement or rocking of restoration into place, okay. At the same time, it increases the surface area of walls that could provide axial retention or axial frictional retention. Then the extension of your proximal axial grooves should be extended up to the cavo surface angle without any undercuts, because if you have any undercut, okay, your wax pattern will be fractured and you will not benefit from these proximal axial grooves. It will not be clear in your casting, it will not be reproduced at all, okay, and your casting will come absolutely flat without this lateral extension. Then these spaces will be occupied by cement or maybe by voids and will be considered as stress concentrating areas and weak areas, okay. That's why, as being indirect, as your restoration is being indirect, you are in need to extend it for up to the cavo surface angle, and it will guide your restoration during seating it into the cavity. For direct restoration, if you are in need for this added retentive feature, okay, you are not in need to extend it up to the cavo surface angle, especially for amalgam, okay? You just extend it from the gingival floor up to the axial, the palpal floor along the axial wall only, not up to the cavo surface angle, okay? And also, it should be in a buccal direction and lingual direction rather than axial, okay? And the matter of being with undercut or not is not to that importance, okay, because already it will provide both axial and lateral retention by being cut and representing an undercut in the buccal and lingual walls, okay, of the proximal cavity. But nowadays, by using adhesive materials, okay, we are not in need for this extensive damage and destruction of valuable sound tooth structure to add a retention. Even extension for retention is now a highly questionable item, considering the conservation of tooth structure. You have too many other ideas, except if you are preparing as a box cavity only. Sometimes without occlusal extension, sometimes you are in need for this grooves, and it will be the only way for lateral retention, okay? Then, using fine tapered stone, okay, you are now in need to flare your proximal cavity. It should be flared as maximum as possible, okay, to avoid any undercuts that will interfere with withdrawal of your wax pattern at the contact area or the area beyond your contact, because you should remember that your contact area is like this, okay, and this is the occlusal embrasure and this is the gingival embrasure, If you are going to bevel these margins, it will create undercuts for the wax pattern at the bevel of the remnants of your buccal and lingual walls of the proximal, beyond the level of the contact area. That's why it is better to be flared rather than beveled, By using gingival marginal trimmer, and or fine tapered stone, your gingival bevel is adjusted, and also you are creating a reverse gingival bevel to provide stability and lateral retention, and also, as we discussed before, it adds axial retention by lengthening the axial wall, which provides much more friction. Then by a disc or fine tapered stone, we increase our flaring to the buccal and lingual area to provide the required protection of the cavo surface margin. It is considered as beveling without formation of undercut beyond the level of contact area I just discussed now. We could use safe-sided diamond disc, but it's much better to use fine tapered stone. Then, beveling of all cavo surface margins, as we mentioned before, it could be a short bevel or a long bevel. It differs according to your evaluation for the required axial retention, how much is the dimensions and surface area of your cavity preparation, how much is the details, what are the depths of your cavity, and your final evaluation for evaluating the required axial retention of your cavity. You will select between short bevel, part of enamel thickness, and long bevel, which includes the full thickness of enamel, starting from the dentino enamel junction up to the cavo surface angle. This is the final shape of finished compound class 2 cavity preparation for cast cold restoration. You could note the full bevel of the cavo surface margins of occlusal portion. You could note the proximal axial grooves and how it is cut in expanse of buccal and lingual rather than axial, and also it is extended without undercuts from the gingival floor up to the cavo surface margin. The complete bevel by flaring the buccal and lingual walls, extended flare, to cover or to bevel the cavo surface margins of buccal walls and lingual wall of the proximal box without creating undercut beyond the level of the contact area. Also, what about the gingival bevel and reverse gingival bevel? This is the first preparation, which is the most commonly used or nearly the absolutely used preparation, except for very rare cases, which is the black box preparation. Then comes, what is the slice preparation? The slice preparation, it doesn't differ than that of the box cavity, from the occlusal point of view, From the occlusal point of view, as you could compare the below, the lower down schematic diagrams, One is box and the other is slides, but from the occlusal point of view, they are the same, and the same preparation except for proximal ditching. You are not going for proximal ditching technique, you are not going to cut axial wall, gingival floor, at the creating step, and all of these. You just have a fine tapered stone or a safe-sided diamond disc, that's why you are in need for accessibility, just to slice your proximal wall, to be absolutely flat, in occlusal direction with occlusal convergency, in order to not having any undercuts with a feather edge finishing line, Also, your preparation will not have a guide to be properly placed, because your restoration will come as a rounded slice. This rounded slice with your divergent wall, it may seat as this towards the buccal or towards the lingual. There will be a little bit rocking in your restoration. You are in need for a guide. This guide is created by proximal dovetail, occlusal lock, or grooves cut inside your slice to guide it. Then, such a condition, you are in need for any cut form, just to guide your restoration, to be placed in the proper position in the cavity. Again, this could be by proximal dovetailing of the other side. This could be through closing lock within the bulbar floor, or most commonly to cut a proximal axial groove, or to cut, sorry, an axial groove, okay, within the axial wall. The preparation is entailing slicing the proximal surface with curved random or diamond disc. Okay, the sliced proximal surface should be slightly inclined towards the occlusal in order to avoid any creation of undercut. Then cut a groove within the sliced axial wall using the tapered fissure pair, fine tapered fissure pair, as we mentioned, just to guide the proper placement of your final restoration and also to provide lateral at the axial retention. This type of preparation, okay, is only indicated in certain restricted cases because you don't have walls, okay, to allow burnishing, okay, of the gold. Your cavo surface margins are exposed to the outer environment and your cement line mostly are exposed to outer environment. So it is used mainly when gold is indicated or cast gold is indicated as a bridge retainer. Then you need to minimize your cutting and conserve as much as of tooth structure. And if it is a carious preparation, okay, it is indicated in cases where your caries is just limited to the middle third of the proximal surface with minimal extension toward the axial. But you should consider that the tooth haven't severely constricted cervical anatomy. It should has a natural or a normal cervical anatomy. Okay, at the same time, you should consider the accessibility. It is much better to be within the mesial or to be prepared for the mesial surfaces rather than the distal far one, because we are afraid from our disc or we are afraid from our fine tapered stone to injure the neighboring tooth, and there is no proper visibility and there is no proper accessibility. Okay, that's why it is not commonly used nowadays. If we inspect this picture, we could notice the difference between the two preparations. The most distal one is a black box, okay, both occlusally are the same, while the mesial one is proximal slice. You could note from the first molar, okay, the distal cavity is prepared in the form of box, while the mesial, due to accessibility, is prepared in the form of slice. You could note the rounded or the circular margins of our proximal slice compared to buccal wall, gingival floor of the proximal black box type preparation. Finally, let us review a case report, which is a recent one, not old one, as we all think that gold is an old-fashioned restoration. Okay, this case report for these, to replace these composite resin restorations. And this is what we would be in a wondering state. Okay, how we could replace something recent with something old-fashioned. Okay, in such a condition, in this condition, we have the tooth, teeth 14, 15, 16, 17. Okay, they have a badly formulated proximal contact, because already if you noticed this on the mesiobuccal cusp of first molar, okay, we could note this occlusal facet that indicates that this patient, okay, have a parafunctional eccentric occlusal habits. That's why you could note that not only the operator formulates the contact in a bad manner, but also the patient have extra eccentric parafunctional occlusal habits that wear your composite. Okay, that's why the case is not indicated for composites or for ceramics, either direct or indirect, whatever your technique, because if you go for direct composite or indirect composite material, whatever the technique, okay, then it will abrade, okay, and also the contact area composite against composite as that for the 5 and the 6, okay, will also will open the contact, okay, and worsen the condition of your occlusion, okay. Number two, if you are going to replace it with ceramics, ceramics will already abrade the antagonist tooth structure of the lower arch, okay. Amalgam, okay, will suffer although the cavity is minimal, but amalgam we are afraid of flow and creep that also will not serve well in such a condition, okay, regarding the proximal contact. If you examine the case, you could note that these eccentric occlusal habits, okay, leads to unusual occlusion of the right side of the patient, okay. The patient could not occlude in maximum intercuspation, okay, either in lateral movement or in rest, okay, or in centric, okay. When he comes in centric occlusion, as you could see in the left picture, okay, his teeth is not occluding or interdigitated properly. Let us follow what will happen. This is our preparation. All our box cavities, okay, just a little bit diverge about 5 to 8 degrees, okay, with cavo surface bevel. Walls are absolutely flat, slightly diverge, line angles are sharp, okay, palpal floor are flat and smooth, okay. And this picture obviously illustrate and indicate the parafunctional habits, which is clear considering the contact areas or the centric holding areas of all teeth, including the cusp tips and the ridges of premolars and molars. Then this is the impression, elastomeric impression. This is the dye and wax pattern, okay. And this is the ease of manipulation, the convenience of manipulation. You could reproduce exactly the form and anatomy. You could check it on articulator. You could reconstruct and reproduce your contact properly, adjust your relation, adjust your occlusion and your articulator, okay, until you could inspect and make sure that the patient bite in centric with maximum interdigitation. These are our restorations, okay, and these are our restoration placed on our dye, okay. Then comes our restoration cemented into place, and you could inspect how beauty the reproduction of your contact, okay, how beauty the accuracy of our lab technician to reproduce not only the anatomy but also the marginal accuracy. And considering your occlusion, you could note in this picture, okay, the patient is now biting in maximum intercuspation, okay, its centric relation is adjusted, okay, from the right side and from the left side also and from the frontal view. This is the case before and this is after. You could compare between them how much we accurately reproduce our anatomy and contact. Okay, finally, those are my textbooks, okay, that I get my knowledge from it. You could go for them for extra readings if you would like, okay. Finally, feel free to ask, as your questions are welcomed all the time, by commenting to this video, and I will reply to your questions or to your inquiry as soon as possible. Finally, I would like to thank you for assigning this time to listen to this episode, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel and activate the notification to get all the updates of my channel. Thank you, Yasser Al-Wasifi.